Good morning, everybody. Today we're happy to have Vic Nalwa. He's the president and CEO of FullView Cameras. And he got a PhD at Stanford Electrical Engineering back in 87 and then went to work at Bell Labs, where he developed this technology, spun it out to a company that makes these really interesting cameras. So Vic, happy to have you here. Take it away.
Thank you, Dick. So I'm going to talk about the cameras we make. And this is the outline of the talk today. I'll give you an overview of FullView cameras and the patents it FullView owns, describe some applications of these cameras, and then discuss some competing designs. Say a few more words about the FullView camera design and compare it with against its alternatives. And then go at greater length into outwardly pointing cameras, which is basically what Google Street View uses. And so I wrote up a small white paper on that because it was particularly pertinent. Say a few words about panoramic image display, which is far less researched than the cameras themselves, and then summarize what FullView has to offer. So FullView cameras were invented in 1995. I know around here it seems eons ago, but it's still within the life of the patents that were subsequently issued at Bell Labs. We provide video that is up to spherical, but 360 by 360, I mean 360 degrees horizontally and 360 degrees plus minus 180 degrees vertically. The video is live and seamless, and as far as live video goes, there's no one who can offer competing image resolution. And the paradigm is that any number of users can be seeing the same event simultaneously, with each viewer free to look around, pan, tilt, zoom in any direction. The basic camera operation is shown above in the next slide. You have a bunch of mirrors. The mirrors are flat, they are not curved. And cameras are looking off, one camera is looking off each mirror, except one camera, a single camera need not be looking off any mirror. So the key is that the images are not blended, they are mosaiced. There's no blending at all, and yet it is the seams that you would expect to see where the camera images from different cameras come together are typically not noticeable and definitely not distracting. And of course, the reason we are able to mosaic these images is that all the cameras are looking out from a single viewpoint, and so there's almost a single viewpoint, and so there's no parallax. So the idea was, 1995 was like a year before the internet took off, but the idea was that the initial application was video conferencing. Bell Labs was a part of AT&T. And the idea now is that you have these cameras sitting somewhere, and different people are looking at the same scene simultaneously. Each user, as I mentioned earlier, can pan, tilt, zoom, look around without interfering with any other user. Most of you might not recall this, but in the late 90s, Wimbledon and US Open had actual pan, tilt, zoom cameras sitting for the more important matches. But people had to get in queue as to who would control that PTZ camera. So FullView's patents, which are 14, basically protect its design, which is the physical camera arrangement, the method of putting the images together, and quite importantly, the product of method. So if someone was to use, the thinking behind this was we were concerned that, say, images are being produced in Africa and being shipped to the US, and because the physical device is sitting in Africa, we will not have any patent protection. So we have protection on those images. They can't be brought into the US. We have successfully enforced our patents against entities that are fairly small and very large. applications are, and some of these applications, most of these slides are from the 90s. So some of these applications are just coming into the market now. The applications are, one application is virtual presence, and this was the initial intended application. So again, I know I'm repeating myself. Many users are looking at the same scene, and they want a sense of presence. And what they want is they want high color fidelity, true seamlessness, and it might be to watch a rock concert or to do video conferencing. And so they're really looking for good looking images, even if the images are not as clear as they can be. And I'll clarify that in a few slides. We licensed our technology to Microsoft for its round table. What is sitting here is the round table. So some of our initial trials were, we did some, this is a camera for virtual presence. We did a trial with the AT Association of Tennis Professionals, and they have some matches in Hartford, Connecticut every year. So the image above is of one such exhibition match. And below we did some internet webcasts, this one with David Bowie from New York City. So what Microsoft had, and the reason for this view graph is it might be pertinent to how Google is acquiring Street View images today. What Microsoft had for many years was the device on the left. They had outwardly pointing cameras, and people who have not studied the physics of the device often think that you can do enough software processing and get rid of and create seamless images. That it's just a matter of doing enough or intelligent enough computation, and you will end up with seamless images. That's not true. I'd like to convince you today that no matter how much processing you throw at the problem, you will never get seamless images in general. So Microsoft went from what is on the left to what is on the right. That's the new device. They actually pictures of this particular camera I took yesterday. And the application that sustained us through most of, until we got Microsoft to license our technology, is situational awareness. And that's basically the Department of Defense. Here, the goal is slightly different from virtual presence. What you want to see as much as you can, as clearly as you can, and you're not really interested in seamlessness if it is at the expense of seeing as much as you can. And so the difference is that, one difference is they wanted black and white cameras because they have more sensitivity. They want to be able to see under moonlight or under half a moon. And the other difference is that they do not want seamless luma and chroma right across the panoramic image, because when you try and do that, you're inevitably going to make some areas really dark and some really bright. And although the overall image might look more pleasing, you will not be able to see detail in the dark and bright areas. So basically, you sacrifice the dynamic range when you try and optimize the seams. Several of our competitors, some of whom are still around, have gotten Department of Defense contracts. But as far as I know, we are the only ones who have actually gone all the way to deployment. So we are a prime contractor for deploying our cameras on aircraft carriers, the next generation of aircraft carriers. So others went to some phase, but they never went to deployment. The cameras on an aircraft carrier are mounted on the control tower. And the reason for using these cameras on aircraft carriers is that they wanted to reduce the size of the control tower and get the operator. There's a person sitting with a camera in every control tower on an aircraft carrier. And his job is to just track every landing and takeoff. And if there's a mishap, they go back and review the tape. So this is not really a security type application. It's just monitoring what is going on the aircraft carrier. And they decided if they could get images that were good enough and gave a sense of enough of a sense of presence on the deck, that they could get that guy off the deck and put him under the deck, where apparently it's much cheaper to put a person. And they have run a series of trials, and they have approved, so that they've already built into the next generation's design. There'll be no person sitting on the deck manning an aircraft, manning a physical camera. The person will be under the deck. He'll have control of a pan-tilt zoom camera, and he'll have full view cameras to let him see or her see where to direct that pan-tilt zoom camera. I want to say a few words of about the camera we built for the Navy, because Dick had raised the question of whether our cameras are robust enough to withstand being, I guess, dashed into tree branches or dust, dirt, rain, snow. So the Navy, so the main thing we did for the Navy is really ruggedization. That the technology was invented while I was at Bell Labs, but you know, there's a long way, large gap between technology and a product people can use. And so what they needed is, they needed, other than, I mean, you know, standard features, these are, the resolution is low compared to static images, but for video images, this is considered fairly good resolution. Most of the funding from the Navy is for ruggedization. They needed a housing which was relatively weatherproof, so it's nitrogen pressurized, there's EMI shielding, there's a lot of electromagnetic interference on aircraft carriers. There's some heating, and now there will be cooling. We'll put in some peltiers in case, you know, things get really hot. It's like a hot house. You have a camera sitting in a hot house. You have a glass window, and you have no vents because you want to protect your devices with nitrogen. And so things get really hot, like 150 Fahrenheit or even higher inside. So we're going to put in some cooling. And they're going to, we're not there yet. By the time they finish, it'll be a military grade, this particular device will be military grade. It is not that we would need to use the same technology for an application such as Street View, but you know, we would have learned a lot from what is needed to make something really rugged and use some of those lessons to what we could do. So one of people who are not familiar with panoramic images, their biggest, when they first saw it, I mean, today most of the people are familiar, but in the 1990s, many people had never seen a panoramic image. I know there were Kodak cameras with a shutter moving around, but many people had never seen, and even when they saw it. So the big concern was, if you look at the bottom, that why are straight lines curved? And so it's an artifact of that we cannot display a very wide angle image on a flat surface without curving the lines, because the lines are actually, because our field of view is actually wrapping around. And so this is just probably now an obsolete slide, which shows that the curve lines could be made straight if you narrowed your field of view. So now I want to, please feel free to interrupt me at any time. I want to go on to what are the alternatives to FullView's design. So the first alternative is outwardly pointing cameras, that you have a bunch of cameras looking in different directions, and you will stitch those images together. I will say more about this design later, but at this point, I just want to point out that the cameras are inherently different. By inherently different, I mean you can't really map any image. The images from the different cameras are inherently different. You cannot map an image from one camera to an image from another camera in general. I mean, it doesn't matter how much processing you do. There'll be some objects, surfaces that will be visible in one image, they will not be visible in the other image. You'll have to make assumptions, and you'll have all sorts of artifacts that some of which I'll illustrate. They will be guesswork, and there'll be mistakes. There's no way around it. I won't discuss the lower half of this slide because I'll be going into it in greater detail later. So these are some papers that are relatively old by now, but you know, they had a bunch of cameras looking out, and they tried to blend the images. And if you look at the images carefully, there's all sorts of blurring. So these are academic papers, so we can imagine that people are putting their best foot forward, and you know, they devoted all the computational resources and all the tricks they could think of to these one or two instances they are including in their paper. Then we had, either you're going to have blurring and things are going to be blurred where the images come together, or things are just going to fall apart. And these are images from the rover. And perhaps not very clear on the screen, but you can always, I can probably leave a bunch of a copy of my presentation with Dick. But if you zoom in, you'll see that objects are breaking apart. You know, half an object is to the left, half is to the right, and because they are artificial objects, man-made objects, you don't notice it as much. But if a person's face, you know, splits in two, it becomes unacceptable for a whole host of applications that we are interested in. Now, another design that was proposed and even, in fact, implemented, and there's a product based on this, is you have a camera or some other aperture rotating. And the biggest problem is that if things are moving, whether objects or the camera itself, you get all sorts of distortion. Still, it's a useful technology for the inside of museums, and there's a company called Panoscan, which actually produces really beautiful images of museums where if you don't have any moving objects, you can get really high resolution using this technique. But again, another academic paper, and you can see the guy wasn't still during the presentation. The guy was circled, and so his face is split in two. So the next design, which has probably been around the longest for about 100 years or more now, is a fisheye lens. And the problem with a fisheye lens is, other than the fact that you need a really small aperture and so really long exposure times or very bright light to capture useful images that are in focus, it's also the problem that you're limited to one sensor, and in fact, most of the sensors, about half the sensors wasted if it's a 4x3 sensor. And there was a company that was doing fairly well based on this technology called iPix, but they were trying to get into the video space and, you know, they went bankrupt a couple of years, maybe 1 year or 2 years ago. Go ahead.
Can you say why this fisheye is out of focus at the periphery?
Oh, why is it out of focus at the periphery? If the aperture is small enough, I don't think it's necessarily out of focus. It is just that everything is being compressed more, so things are at a lower resolution. So a variant of this is a curved mirror. I've never really understood what is the advantage of a curved mirror over a fisheye lens, but it is out there, so I thought I'd mention it. The problem with a curved mirror is that it's not a simple variant of a plane mirror. There's a big difference. With a curved mirror, as I try and illustrate in the figure, in the lower figure, but perhaps, you know, you won't be able to look at it enough to appreciate it, that things are typically, when you see a point in a curved mirror, it is not the image of a point, it's the image of an area and space, and that's quite unlike a plane mirror. And so things are generally completely out of focus. We are able to see a curved mirror, like sometimes in basements they have these part hemisphere mirrors, and we are able to see it because we're only looking at one point and we optimize our aperture for that one point we are looking at, or one point on the mirror. But if you try and capture an image of the mirror with a camera, you always have only a very small section that's in focus and the rest is all blurred. So again, there are some papers based on curved mirror, on the use of a curved mirror. So FullView's design is, as I illustrated earlier, and as lying on the table, is basically a bunch of mirrors, flat mirrors. And the beauty of a flat mirror is that no matter how large the aperture or where the aperture is relative to the mirror, everything always looks clear. And so if you have two mirrors and two cameras, you can arrange your cameras such that each camera is looking from the center of the arrangement. So when you have a planar mirror, things are really simple. The basis of all our designs is this, that when a camera looks off a mirror, it is as if the camera is looking out into the world from its mirror reflection. That's all we use. We use it again and again in different ways, and I'll show you a whole bunch of variants, but that is the principle. So it's not ray tracing and, you know, trying to find what went where. It's just the camera's, it's as if the camera's at its mirror reflection, and then we just go from there. The big issue, of course, is what do we do at seams? And so typically, if you were to actually co-locate, so I keep saying we co-locate the cameras, effectively co-locate the cameras, and they have no parallax, but that's not really true. If you were to actually precisely co-locate the cameras, you will have wedges within which, no matter how good your mirrors are, you will have wedges within which you will not see the world. And when it's a wedge, you know, it's always expanding, and eventually people will disappear, cars will disappear if you go far enough. So you cannot afford to have wedges. You cannot have a diverging blind zone. You have to have it either converging or parallel. So what FullView proposed was that it'll have parallel blind zones, but they're so thin that at the resolution of a pixel, you don't notice it if you go far enough. And far enough depends on both the resolution and the thickness of the blind zone. And so the next thing is whether the other area of emphasis of our research was basically calibration. You take these cameras, you build them, you calibrate them once, and that's it. You never touch them again. As long as they're not dropped or broken, you stick with the same calibration, and you know, like on an aircraft carrier, and months later, years later, things still line up. So there are several variants of FullView's design, and I'll quickly go through them. Essentially, all of them use the same principle, that when a camera is looking off a flat mirror, it's as if the camera is looking out from its mirror reflection. So we propose that you could see, you need not be trying to create panoramic images. You could actually be trying to create a high-resolution sensor, quadrupling the number of pixels, but keeping your field of view the same. So you could have four cameras looking into a pyramid, and they're all effectively looking out from here, but looking down. Looking out from the common effective viewpoint, but looking down. Then this is another variant that you could have mirrors arranged like this to expand your vertical field of view. This particular variant was implemented by UNC in somewhere around 1998 or 99. And this variant I referred to earlier, this was implemented by University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign in the early, maybe 2004. That you can try and get a spherical. So there's a virtual location of all the cameras, but that space still exists. So there's a facility to put one single camera at that physical location. And so that's what we do here. We put that one single camera at the physical location, and the other cameras are just sharing that location virtually. So then, you know, this is a figure from one of our patents that you can just nest these, and you can just keep building up. And again, it's the exactly the same principle that I mentioned earlier. And then there's always the question of seams, but that's been really the focus for our last 10 years, just focusing on the seams. Once you know how to nail the seam, it doesn't matter how many seams you have, you can just, you know, get it right every time. And then there was, you know, and this has never been, sorry, go ahead.
I didn't understand.
Okay. So you have a bunch of cameras. Some cameras are within one pyramid. So let's look at the, if you look at the lowermost camera, it's looking off a planar mirror and looking down. Then you have a bunch of cameras over the planar mirror. It's looking off the pyramid and looking to the edge of the planar mirror and then out upwards. But it's looking upwards, up to the seam, up to the edge of the pyramid. And then you have another bunch of cameras that are starting from that edge and going to the next edge. You know, when I proposed these, this looked like it was a hypothetical design. This looked, people have implemented this. So I don't know how practical it is, but I believe it can be implemented. It's not as academic as it sounds. So then there was a question of whether you can have stereo imagery, and the obvious way to have stereo imagery is to take two of these and put it side by side, but you'll get vertical disparity. You'll get vertical displacement, but people want to have horizontal displacement, you know. They want to simulate their eyes. They don't want vertical disparity. They don't want one viewpoint to be low and one to be high with one pyramid on top of the other. So there's another way to do it. It is, again, you take a bunch of cameras and try and co-locate them at two different points within the pyramid, or a bunch of points, and so you can have panoramic stereo imagery. This is just to give you a flavor of what is possible under the basic paradigm. So these are the alternatives. IPEX is gone. So let me start with the rightmost column first. Be here is no more. Remote reality, VRI and remote reality are still there. They're looking at curved mirrors and creating panoramic imagery. The aperture is really limited, and because they use a single sensor, the resolution is limited too. Then you have a fisheye lens. Again, the resolution is limited by a single sensor. But the fisheye lens is a really good solution for a single, as far as I know, it's the best solution for a single camera. It's a really refined and mature technology, and it's, you know, it is a good it is a reasonably good solution. And then you have multiple cameras looking out. You had immersive media, iMove, Point Grey, and Google is apparently doing that with it for its Street View. The problem with multiple cameras, I'm going to discuss multiple cameras in detail next. The problem with multiple cameras is that parallax. That because of parallax, you cannot produce seamless images. And I'd want to convince you by the end of this talk that you know, there's no way around it. And then you have multiple cameras looking off plane. We'll come back to this. I know I've packed it with, it's dense with details, so I'll try and leave the presentation with Dick. So what is the problem with outwardly pointing cameras, which is in part my focus today? The hurdle is parallax. And that is when you see the world from two different viewpoints, two displaced viewpoints, there's a disparity between the images, and that disparity depends on how far away an object is. And so if two objects are at two different distances, like the star and the pyramid in the background, the relative position between them and the image changes based on the distance between them. As the two objects come closer together and the star moves closer to the pyramid, the images look more similar than they looked before. So the star has moved almost on the green portion in both images, whereas here one star was in the yellow portion and one on the yellow portion and one was on the red. As viewpoints move together, the disparity again decreases. So the parallax decreases. So the reason parallax is hard to overcome, because effectively to resolve parallax, you need to find out what is the depth of each point in space. That is the stereo problem of computer vision. We are able to do it as humans. We are able to get a fairly good idea of depth and do stereo fairly well, but under various constraints, even our system can be fooled. We are making lots of assumptions, and who knows? You know, you don't want this to become a projector figuring out how the brain works. But in computer vision, there's no robust solution, because there are lots of issues. There's this issue of lack of texture. There's an issue of repetitive patterns. And why try and solve a three-dimensional problem when the problem is actually a two-dimensional problem? So I took some. I'm going to give you a bunch of examples from the Ladybug 2, because Google had used it for some time. And it's a representative. It's not, none of these artifacts are unique to Ladybug 2. They are common to all outwardly pointing cameras. So when you have objects that are fairly close, parallax is greater than when objects are far away. And so this is the image in the background of the Ladybug 2 camera's view is from Point Grey's, who's the manufacturer of Ladybug 2, their website. So they have an image of an indoor desk scene. And if you look carefully at the desk scene, I think it's kind of visible. There's ghosting at the desk, at the seams, there's ghosting. Because, I give them credit for, you know, putting up real images on their website rather than all doctored images. This is what you would expect, and this is what they have up on their website. When you buy a Ladybug 2, you're fully aware that you'll see such ghosting when objects are close by. And this is a image from I think the Tour de France of 2008 from Google Maps. And you see that the railing is split apart, and if you might be able to see that the rampart and the road in the background are also split. In this case, it might be because the railing is repetitive, and so in the matching there was some issue, and you know, matching and blending is all approximate affairs, and so you try to make your best guess and live with it. So even if, this is an important point, even if you were able to get perfect matches, So the way you normally find parallax, I just went over this slide really fast, is you match portions of images. You take a portion of one image, you look for the closest match in another image. You might have some overlying algorithms which try and see that all the matches are consistent, but you're basically matching. It doesn't matter which way you're doing it, you're going to match. The problem with matching is that you can't have a point match. You need a window. You need some characteristic, some variation of luma, chroma, geometry to do a match. But as soon as you have a window, that means you're going to average a match over some region. Whatever match you have is going to be precise at no particular place but approximate over an area. Well, the problem is you have some residual disparity. So you get perfect matches, but there's some disparity. You made some approximations to what your best matches are. So again, this might not be very clear on what you see, but if you look carefully at any image that is created through outwardly looking cameras, even when it looks really good, you'll see that the resolution is varying. And if you look at the seams, you will see, like in the box, which is above the building, there's ghosting. And if you look at the street sign, you'll see that it's blurred. It is not really clear. And that there's no way around it, because there's some residual disparity, and you're blending. And blending basically means you're trying to camouflage that residual disparity. If there was no residual disparity, you wouldn't need blending. So what FullView does is basically it reduces the parallax to be small enough that it doesn't need to blend images. This is an image, I believe, from 1998 or maybe 1999 of a lab of it was my lab inside Bell Labs. And there are two seams there, and the people are really close. And if you look at the image at our website or on the slides carefully, you'll see that, you know, the guy's that he's a really famous acoustics researcher called Jim West, who's wearing a blue shirt. And the wrinkles on his shirt are absolutely continuous across the seam. So there's a slight color mismatch, because there is no blending of even of color in these images, but the geometry is fairly well matched. And that is because the images have relatively low parallax. They are placed side by side and in a predetermined fashion. It's not scene dependent. The other thing with outwardly looking cameras is that everything depends on the scene. When objects are close, your algorithm will produce a different result. When objects are far away, it produces a different result. So we offer much higher and more uniform resolution than outwardly pointing cameras for two reasons. One, that we don't need image overlap, because we're not going to match images. And so we can use, you know, have narrower fields of view for each camera when we're using the same number of cameras, maybe 30% or 50% narrower. And so you get higher resolution because of that. And the second, because we don't blend images, we don't reduce the image resolution wherever we blend those. So let me say a few words about panoramic image displays, and then I'll take questions and let you examine the camera on the table. So this is when I started out on this project in 95, the big issue was how do you show panoramic images without disorienting viewers? And you know, it's exactly the same problem as how do you show the map of the world on a flat piece of paper. And so, because the Arctic and the Antarctic are not so important to us, we live with gross distortions. You know, they appear much larger than they really are. But so the simplest way, and that is what we were using for a while, is to just take the view around and wrap it and unwrap it. Take a cylindrical view and unwrap it into a flat view. Another way is to split up a cylindrical view into two views, and the top view, the top view is as if you're looking forward, but the bottom view is a mirror image of the top of what you would see if you were looking in front. So it's like driving a car, that you have a front view through your windshield, and then you have a rear view through your rear view mirror. The importance of this type of arrangement is, rather than just splitting up a cylindrical view into two, that whatever's on the left is on the left in both the views. It wouldn't be if you didn't flip the lower image, and whatever's on the right is on the right. Or you might want to, this is the most common view, that you have a larger resolution image, a lower resolution full image, and then people can select where to look based on that. So in summary, full view cameras offer up to spherical video at full frame rate using a regular PC. When we started, we couldn't even get four streams into a computer, so we were using a frame grabber with a multiplexer and streaming through four views, and I think the processor speed was 200 megahertz or something like that. The resolution of our live imagery is unrivaled because we are able to use multiple sensors, unlike the single camera designs. And the multi-camera designs can't produce live views because they need more time and computation to produce their images. The alternatives either provide low resolution at low frame rate, or you have composite images with artifacts. So we can, because we have patent protection, we alone can offer multiple cameras looking out from effectively a single viewpoint of mirrors. And the last, what I want to end on is that we can take any outwardly pointing camera design and without changing any of your software, hardware, reconfigure those particular cameras. We'll change the lenses because we don't need such wide lenses. Reconfigure that particular bunch of cameras such that we can get rid of parallax and produce better looking images. So what you have, let me close this. I'll open it if need be later. What you have on the table is Microsoft's implementation of our intellectual property. And I'll be happy to take questions. So you can come and you can look at it. And you know, I'm fairly close. And I think could we have more light? No, that's okay. So, you know, you still, it's not scene dependent. You can still vary, you should be very able to see the scene. I must be spamming.
You can see the scene from light mismatch, but not from stitching artifacts.
Because there is no stitching,
right?
So they just put together. So you can see the scene if you know what to look for, and this is your specialty. You can see the.
Sure. Can you comment on Disney had obviously the search vision from a long time ago.
Yes.
Use the microphone.
Okay, sorry. So the question is, Disney had circle vision, and could you comment on that?
Well, more to the point, did circle vision implement all the cameras at the same focal point?
So the question is, did circle vision implement all the cameras at the same viewpoint? And the answer is yes. So when I implemented this design in 95, I had seen circle vision, but I was not aware that they were using flat mirrors. But since then, I did become aware of that, and I looked at their patents, and we referenced their patent in our patents. What Disney was doing was it was depending on, they implemented a design where all the cameras were effectively looking from the same viewpoint. And what they were depending on, they leave gaps between their particular images, and they leave it to, and so you don't, my understanding is you don't really see the full scene. You see angular gaps, but that is acceptable to us because it's as if we are looking out of a window with, I think the term is bullions. And so we assume that, okay, there's some obstruction there and we won't see it. But the difference is that you can't move your head. Unlike in a real window, you can move your head and see what's behind the obstruction. But in circle vision, you obviously cannot.
So the difference is that Disney circle vision did not have the mirrors extend so that they touched each other, and the cameras set up to use the full frame of the mirror.
I don't know if they, I haven't seen their capture device. So the question was, is the difference that the mirrors in the Disney implementation did not touch each other? So I have not seen their physical device. I don't know if the mirrors touched each other, but I do know that they wanted their viewpoints to be at the same location. So that itself would defeat any possibility of creating a composite seamless image. And not, I haven't been to Circle Vision recently.
It's good.
They actually have gaps between the screens where they have
projectors. Exactly. Yeah. So Dick knows they have nine cameras and nine projectors, and so it's a slightly different, it seems similar, but it's slightly different. The interesting thing is they actually had a lawsuit against in the 60s, Disney had a lawsuit against somebody who tried to circumvent their patent by introducing some gaps, not to create seamless images, but just to get around the patent, and the guy lost that lawsuit.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.